So first of all, who am I? My name is Daniel Pyrathon, as they said before. I come from Rome, which is a really beautiful city. If you ever happen to be there, get some amazing food because it's really beautiful. And most importantly, I'm really happy to be here because I actually learned most of the programming through Python and most of the web through Django. So basically, I'm really happy to be here today and try to give back something to the community which I owe so much to. So 4 months ago, I graduated. So now I'm an ex-bachelor student. And yeah, in a very informal way. Or at least mine was a very informal, not the whole graduation. And yeah, I also made it on the paper, so. Mom is very proud. Yes, yes. And so, this is basically, in three words, who am I? I'm currently working in a company called Pathflow, where we do business intelligence through machine learning. And yes, we do use some Django for the front end, obviously. I'm pushing for that. And a little details about the Google Summer of Code. So who's heard about the Google Summer of Code? Many people, okay. Just for the people who don't know about it, it's a global program that offers students stipends to write code for open source projects. It's Google's way, for example, to give back to open source. But most importantly, it's a great way for us, at least for me, to give back, a great occasion to give back to open source. So I'm not really pitching, but this has been a really amazing experience for me, and I hope all this talk documents it. And so whoever is eligible to do this and wants to do it, trust me, it's a really, really amazing experience. And these are a couple of bureaucratical details. There are nearly 200 open source organizations. I can speak about my amazing experience with Django, but in case you want, there are also the 199. So yeah. And this is an example of one of the tasks that the Django project, released for this year's Summer of Code. In this case, it's the one I did. And this is what we're going to be speaking about today. So first of all, what is the Meta API? In a very, very simple way, it's an internal API that is hidden under the Meta object within each model. And it's what allows us to define the least minimum things on top of a field and then let Django do all the magic for us. And in fact, the expressivity that, for example, the Django model framework has is amazing. And nothing would have been possible, like, for example, admin model forms, if it wasn't for this meta object. And so this is what Django uses to do introspection, and it's what makes basically everything possible. So basically, you might not know about it, but you use it all the time. It's really, really fundamental. So this is an example of what you can find inside this meta object. So you can find properties about the model itself. Like, for example, you have model names, the app name, or information like, is the model an abstract model, proxy model, swapped model, a bit of everything. And also other like bare metal information like database table name, table permissions, primary key. Other really important things are also about the metadata of the model fields. And so this is basically, what fields does this model have? Okay, give me the field instances. And also, what relations does this model have with other fields? Or what relations do other fields have with this model? And so this is ridiculously fundamental for the entire system to work. And so in fact, what apps use the model API, the model meta API? So we have admin that manages to generate amazing amount of information. It manages to generate URL paths and all of this just by giving it really minimal information. So this is one of the apps. Then migrations, we've heard about that today. And you can just easily see how fundamental the Meta API can be for migrations. We have model forms. And just think of it. We're giving Django the least information possible. And it manages to generate amazing, let's say, dynamic forms and stuff. It manages to generate a lot of HTML for us, just giving it the minimal information possible. And the way it does this is through the Meta API. Finally, Are other developers have been using this system? And the answer is yes, there have been. We have amazing projects like the Django REST framework, non-rel, Tagit, and many, many more projects that would have never been possible if it wasn't for this great API. And although it's an internal, so developers shouldn't really be using it, developers are forced to use it because by using it, they manage to create these amazing packages. So at the end of the day, developers have always used it, even though it's not officially supported. And yeah, so therefore, there's a big need for a public API, and it's quite clear. And that's why Russell, five years ago, released this task. And that's why I decided to take it as quite an interesting challenge. I found that the best way to benefit from this talk is to divide it into three parts. And that is yesterday, today, and tomorrow. When I speak about yesterday, I mean basically what's currently still on master, because only a very, very small part of my Summer of Code project has already been merged. But this is where I started from. So this is basically yesterday. Today will be where my pull request is today, 461 commits later, and basically the way it looks like. And finally, is tomorrow is basically our vision for the future and some interesting ideas that are coming out as a set of, a long discussion. So yeah, yesterday. This is, just a small window of what the Meta API is supposed to look like. In terms of, these are some of the main entry points of Meta throughout the entire system. And when I mean about entry points, I don't mean stuff that is used internal to the Meta API. I mean, these are the entry points that are called within Django, within the Django ecosystem, and also outside of Django through the third-party applications. So if you look at the names, they might be, quite easily understandable. Like, you know, you probably know what a many-to-many is, get many-to-many with model, get field, and all these. But then there's this one main thing, which is called related object, which, when I say this word, people don't really like it. But yeah, I understand. There is this main distinction between what a field is and what a related object is. And this, I think, is fundamental to understand, the way the Meta API works and also the future vision we have throughout this API. So fields is anything that you defined on the model with or without a relation. So basically, everything that you put on top of a model. You have a Boolean field, a car field, but also a foreign key, anything that you put on there. Then you have related objects. And related objects are objects created dynamically by Django as a consequence of a relation to another model with the current model. So basically, if I have two models, brand and item, and an item has one brand, and a brand has many items. So basically, one-to-many relationship, then at this point, you know, to implement this, you'd probably, you know, easily just put a foreign key from on item to brand. Automatically, Django generates a second, object, which is called a related object, on top of brand, pointing to item as a consequence of this relation. And this is just a Django-rated thing. It just has no concrete implementation on the database. But it's what Django uses to do its magic. So for example, nested queries and stuff like this. Basically, related objects, or at least relations that are pointed to from other models, are fundamental to Django's functioning. So other thing, this is what I call the meta of the Meta API in terms of this is what it looks like. And by the way, sorry, because I actually got it wrong. I was supposed to add more of them. I got it wrong. But basically, this is what it looks like. So these are I'm sorry for the black on the black, but this is basically a whole dependency chain. And as you can see, we've identified more or less 10 entry points. Okay, so when I mean my entry points is parts of the code which handle logic, parts of the code which actually are searching through the model's information and grabbing, obtaining information. Then we have cache properties. And if you don't know what cache properties are, that's fine. Just think they're properties for now. Then I'll go through on later and I'll explain, let's say, a bit more verbose about cache properties. But we've already seen a couple of things related to cache properties today. And finally, most importantly, there is this distinction between four different types of fields. Fields, many-to-many, related objects, and related many-to-many. And so that's quite strange, because before I was speaking about these two main concepts, which are fields and related objects, right? And now I'm speaking about four different, let's say, types of fields. And that is just because it's an implementation detail. This is the way Django works best, in a sense. Or at least this is the way Django evolved in working, okay? At least from my understanding. And so the distinction between what related objects are, for example, what related many-to-many are, it's just basically they're part of the same family, so they're all part of related objects. Just that one contains only many-to-many relations, at least related objects coming from many-to-many relations, and the other one contains related objects from, excluding the ones from many-to-many relations. So these are just implementation details, and so they shouldn't really scare your understanding. The main conceptual understanding is fields and related objects. This is just because Django likes working this way in terms of the implementation is this. And so finally, this is just a look on the Meta API entry points that we were speaking about later. And so this is where we are. I say yesterday because for me it was yesterday, but this is basically where we are today. Okay, this is what the API looks like on master today. And so we go to today, which is actually my today, and hopefully your future. Yeah. I get it quite, yeah. And so basically, it's what's currently on my Forks pull request and not yet into Django. And so we've gone through, let's say, the core team and many other amazing people have gone through many, many iterations of the Meta API. We've gone through many, many design changes, many, many implementation changes. But there's one thing which I am really, really proud of, and that's the fact that we've kept three main, let's say, points always on every iteration. Even if we scrapped it or, you know, we said this design, you know, we can make it better, we've always kept these three points, which I like to call the new Meta API philosophy. And that is an official API that everyone can use without risk of breakage. And this is fundamental because we have lots of packages that depend on this to work. And therefore, they must be able to implement this API safely to do their amazing packages and without the risk of it breaking. And if we do change it, you know, it's going to follow all Django's, let's say, deprecation process. So it's basically safe. Second thing, it's a fast API because it is necessarily fundamental to the entire functioning of the system. Although it's never been treated as a component of itself, the Meta API is used extensively throughout the system. And so if the Meta API is a bottleneck, then the entire system can become, you know, suffers of this bottleneck. So it's fundamental. Finally, an intuited API, which is basically means get all those endpoints that we saw before, and how can we simplify this drastically, making it something intuitive to use, an API which has simple names, easy to understand, and probably won't even need a documentation. Obviously, though, we give you an amazing documentation, so in case. And this is what it looks like today, okay? And I say seven entry points, although, I'm forced to say seven, but I like to say two sometimes, because at the end of the day, what we have here is the two main functions that handle the logic are get fields and get field stop, okay? Those are the two functions which are the main entry points to the entire system, okay? What we have after, okay, those cache properties are basically pre-computed, optimized versions of some commonly used patterns. And what I mean by commonly used patterns are those are the commonly used properties within Django and also outside. So basically, we've identified some of these, and we say, okay, let's just provide some shortcuts for them, okay? And so this is basically what helps make Django fast. But in the same way, on the top, we have an API that is far more simple to use and is far more complex. So there are three main, it tries to be as intuitive as possible. So we have, currently three main return types. And one is field names, which is as simple as return a set of field names. And it's intuitive, it's fast to use, and it's probably going to be already pre-computed by the time you boot up your interpreter or something. So then we have getField, which does exactly what it should do. And by the way, getField already exists. It's already inside the Meta API currently. But what's great is that we are 100% backwards compatible with that getField API, so your code won't break. But also we're adding more features on top of that. And in terms of that, there is no sort of definition in, we're making the API more simple to use, okay? And basically getField just returns a field instance, or it froze a field does not exist error. So intuitive. And then finally, these set of cache properties, including getFields, which are used for iteration. And that is basically an iterable data structure that we'll be speaking about later on. And which contains field instances. So yeah, this is what it looks like in terms of complexity. So we saw before, the previous API, this is what it looks like today. Okay, so we have two main entry points, so two parts that handle the logic, okay, that are getField and getFields, okay. We have five cache properties, which are these here. Yep. And we have one cache layer, which by the way, it's a cache property itself. So it's basically a map of field names and field values, and it's used for field names and getField to be even faster. As a design level, there is only one main distinction, and that is between related objects and fields. So we're going back to that same concept we were speaking about previously, okay? We are simplifying the API, just bringing it back to basically what's on the model and what's pointing to the model, okay? So fields and related objects. And we've also changed the terminology a bit, because we want to make sure that we just basically want to hide the implementation details on top of that. And that is, we're calling them forward as fields, so forward fields, and reverse fields. Reverse fields are basically related objects. So that's the main terminology case. Finally, the previous API never had tests, but saying that is actually inaccurate, because it did have tests as part of the entire framework being tested, okay? Meta API worked great, and it was tested by the entire system. So even though it was never treated as a component of itself, it always was tested indirectly. The new Meta API is treated as a component of itself. And therefore, rather than having documentation, a public API, it also has 46 test cases as of today, which test the entire, Meta API component as itself. So, wait, just going back before, we see that the main logic of the new Meta API is handled here. This part which is called relation tree, and this part which is called getField. And this is what I like to speak to you about now. And so, getField is one of the parts that handles most of the logic. It's it's a single generator function that contains all the logic about where to search for fields. It's only closed in one function. Well, previously we had four or five functions which did this for different types of fields. Here it's only wrapped into one one-to-one function. And so, we just make it more consistent and maintainable this way. Everything else, okay, or it's a cache property, so it's just a pre-computed version of getFields with some parameters, or it's getField, so it's always getting information from getFields. Getfields is a recursive call, so it needs to take into consideration inheritance. It takes into consideration, let's say if you have model inheritance, it'll basically iterate through each model and call itself through each model and basically collect for each step the amount of information that it requires. So yeah, it takes into consideration model swapping, proxy models, inheritance, and calls to get fields are entirely recursive. And that's actually interesting because we can do per layer caching. And what that means is basically we are potentially doing less computation per layer, because if a layer has already been cached, we're not gonna recompute that part. We're just gonna basically fetch the cache and then go on. And so that does end up with more data being retained, but at the end of the day, this does end up with less computation, so more performance. And it's also great because we have, as this function is the only function that handles the logic. So cache invalidation is just basically that entire function will then go recursively and clean the entire cache system. So that's good because we have a centralized cache, and so a centralized cache invalidation. And get fields gets us information from two main parts. So we saw that get fields gets information from each model. For each model, it gets information from two main parts, and that is one part, which are the local attributes inside the meta object. So for example, we have attributes like local fields, local many-to-many, and these are just basically lists, containers of information with field instances that are populated by the meta class system upon import. So as soon as you import your class, the meta class system inside model's model will get all the fields that you've defined and it'll push them inside some of these containers. And so while one of them is just basically searching through the local fields system, so just through the local fields attribute, the other side, we have related objects. And so that can be a bit more complex because related objects is basically which model throughout the entire system is pointing to me. How can I find these models, right? And the problem is that it sometimes can be really, really hard because we have things like swapped models, we have proxy and stuff like that. So it's really, really hard to do this on boot up, okay? Upon field insertion, I tried to do this and it actually resulted in an epic fail. We built this component, which is called the related objects graph. And what it is, it's, let's say, a graph of connections between models. So it's a component that generates a map between models and, parts of the system they point to. What's interesting is that it is very expensive because we have to basically go through, we have to do a brute force approach, look at every field and every model in every app. So that can be very, very expensive. But what's interesting is we're doing it only once, and then we're caching it for the entire system. What I mean by that is that this is somewhat similar to what is currently inside the current master. Okay, this is sort of the way Django currently works. But we're doing even more because well, previously we would just compute the parts of the field, the relations of one single model. Now we're doing just a bit more work. We're doing it a bit more, but then we're doing it for everyone, and then we're caching everything. So basically, this is going to happen only once. And if I before I was speaking about cache property, who's ever used cache property? Yay! Okay. Well, basically, what it is it's really, really excellent. It's a property that is computed once per instance. Okay, so it's just like basically the at property, but then it replaces itself. Okay, with the attribute eternally. So basically, it sort of replaces itself with the result of the function. That's great because we don't even need to. It completely avoids function calls. There's no need to recreate a stack or something. even to just return cash. This is blazingly fast, and it's been a solution to many of at least my personal problems. And yeah, if you're copying and pasting this into your code, I see many people do this in their projects. Just pip install cache property, it's by PyDanny. And yeah, it's a great way to use this. So the relation tree itself is a cache property. So basically what that means is that if the system ever gets to this, if this function ever gets executed, that means that it's the first ever call to the to relation tree, because the second one onwards doesn't even enter this function because it just returns the attribute. But we're doing even more in terms that when we calculate the relation tree graph, what we do is we iterate through all the models inside the system, and what we do is we replace their internal dict with their relation tree. And the relation tree in this case comes from, let's say, their part of the related objects graph. So basically, we are assigning each one of the model their share of cache. And this looks sort of like this. We have four models, cache is empty on all four. This is the first ever call to the relation tree. And the first ever call is done to model one, so model one underscore meta relation tree. This fires the relation tree, and the cache is computed throughout the system and is placed inside every model, right? And that means that the second call just returns the attribute instance. There's no further computation. So this is just done once. Second thing, also cache invalidation can be a sort of a pain sometimes, but the good thing is that we've hooked up clear cache. The clear cache hook of apps automatically goes through and invalidates the entire relation tree. So that's good. We're doing it actually more than what we should do, but this is good because, you know, this is the price we pay for less bugs. So this somehow sort of aids us in going into some bad cache invalidation bugs, traps. And so that's basically the way the relation tree works. It's great because, as I said, if we go back to the system, the way it worked previously, okay, it would only calculate that. Okay, it would only calculate the cache for one. Then when you access number four, okay, it'll have to do some pre-computation. Okay, we're doing a bit more, but we're doing it once only, and that's it. Moving onwards, we use cache properties throughout the system. Told you these are some of the main calls that within and without Django are very used. And we're also adding some new ones, like for example related objects that wasn't there. So these are pre-computed parts of the get fields API call, and they're optimized. They're really, really fast to use. And there's probably most probably once if you are just a Django consumer, and so you're not a Django, let's say a developer of the Django project, you'll probably never find these properties unfilled, because automatically the Django system upon boot up builds the relation tree and will also pre-compute all these properties dynamically because they're queried on startup. And so basically, if you have to use these properties, the expense of using it is basically zero. Second thing I want to speak about is immutability, and this is something that we've basically been doing throughout the system. One of the biggest patterns I realized when looking at the models meta documentation, well, documentation, the code, is that is a big part of the say API calls is what they do is they would pre-compute some cache, but then they would return a copy of that object in memory in order to avoid mutable problems. And that is somewhat not efficient in terms of every time that we're doing something, we are retaining a copy. We are creating a copy and returning it. And so what we're doing here is instead of returning a new copy, we're using, because we are caching everything basically, and because everything is immutable, because we inherit from immutable data structures, and you know, hopefully willingly, you shouldn't be able to mutate these things willingly. Basically, we just return a reference to what you're asking. And that's great because, you know, it's just basically returning a reference, not doing any more copying, and that obviously makes it far less bug prone. And yeah, this is something that's, I was at EuroPython Berlin, and I spent probably one day on this. This is one, like, for example, one of the common calls, which I had refactored, and basically, this is what's happening here. It's using plus equals. And while you may think this is not dangerous, actually, this is, because what this will return is a reference, and then you're basically modifying the reference, and so that, by the way, modifying our cache, and so the system wouldn't work anymore. But the thing is that we create everything as immutable, and you know, we cache everything when possible, and then, you know, we return immutable structures as much as possible. This does impact the way Django consumes the API, because, as I said previously, there are parts of the system that rely on this basically mutating the array in place, or basically just appending to, concatenating two types of properties together. This is a very common pattern. And so what we did is basically we replaced all those parts of code using chain. And using chain is great because you don't have to allocate a new list. It's very fast. But it's also amazing because we can use chain to concatenate two types of, cache properties together. But then we can also use the expressive syntax that, for example, generator comprehension gives us to do filtering and mapping. So yeah, that is... There are some negative aspects of it, obviously. You know that generators, you know, it's a problem when you have to do indexing or multiple iteration. But no one is blocking you from making a copy. We just basically don't give it to you as by default. Okay, by default we give you an immutable, let's say, copy. But then, you know, an immutable reference. But then, if you want to do a copy, you can do it without any problems. We're never going to block you on that. And in fact, we do even more. If you try to mutate something, we will kindly remind you with an attribute error. What we will do here is, as I said, it's a data structure that inherits from Topple. So we built our own sort of small error system inside. And if you try to do this, we will, you know, kindly say the return type of fields should never be mutated. If you want to mutate it, then, you know, just make a copy, and it should be quite simple. Yeah. So that sort of sums it up in terms of the biggest changes for the new Meta API. Obviously, there have been many, many changes to be done, but unfortunately, I couldn't fit them all. This is just a set of them. So we've drastically reduced complexity of the previous API, or at least I personally think that. We've added tests to the previous and current API because some of the tests have already been merged into master for the current API because it's going to be backwards compatible. Performance increase compared to the previous API. And then we have a pull request, which is 465 commits in my second PR as of today. But there are some negative aspects of it. Basically, we have this fully working refactored API for what we have today into Django. But personally, I'm not sure that it's what we want to have in the future, in tomorrow. And that is something which I hope that we'll be sorting out tomorrow at Sprints, because I have some ideas. The core team has a lot of ideas too. So I'm sure that, you know, we'll manage to see understand, let's say, a bigger vision for the future of this API. Finally, please don't bash me, okay, if this is not true. I already tell you. But I've been running Django Bench a bit, and while this is, I don't want to make this anything official, okay, there is a 10% performance increase, and that is a median of 1,000 runs per each test. So we're basically, that's happened like sort of four times or five times. Don't trust me on this. I'm still waiting for the feedbacks, but this is basically where we're heading, okay? This is, These optimizations lead to this, okay? And yeah, this is just another look of at what we have today, okay? Two main entry points, the rest are cache properties. Fully optimized, and most probably, you're never gonna use get fields because you probably have a ready computed version here that you want to use. And so, that leads us to tomorrow. So, what will be my pull request, and hopefully soon in Django? Well, that unfortunately doesn't depend on me, but this is basically sort of a small discussion which has happened on IRC lately, and personally I think it's a great way to go forward. And that's basically, instead of, so we had this problem basically, I told you, we've gone through many, many design iterations. And throughout all these design iterations, there has been one main thing, that is the parameters of get fields changing. Before we had four parameters, you know, as part of the previous API, we had four parameters, data, many fields, many-to-many, related objects, related many-to-many. We went all the way up to like nine parameters plus field options, and then we went all the way down to two. So basically this API is sort of going up and down, and I think it was Konik who once wrote on the pull request saying, oh, the API has changed overnight again. You know, it's just a very common thing. You know, we're really sort of working on trying to get the best formula. But maybe there's a better idea to this other than getting the parameters on get fields. And it's basically to have a different approach which is based on top of two things. The first one is a very, very minimal get fields API. What that means is that this function has just serves for collecting as much as it can, but it has to be as simple as possible. It has to do less filtering possible. On the second part, we have field flags. And what field flags are, and this is an example of what we could have as field flags, this is not anything official, but this is basically what we've been discussing in the last days, are basically a set of attributes on top of each field that are defined, necessarily defined on each field, and that basically indicate their behavior. And so that means that if we have to add things in the future, okay, it's going to be far easier because we don't have to change the get fields API. We just have to change, add or, you know, manipulate some of the properties on top of the field flags. And if in the future, hopefully people, you know, will be able to add their new fields, add their new stores, and let's say, apply even more customization. And so what we're just saying is, you know, implement these and you should be good to go because the entire system queries these. You know, this is the way they ask for, let's say, behavior. And, you know, while, you know, some of them may be quite simple, like, for example, editable is quite understandable. The field is editable. So, for example, if we're showing a form, we might not want to show fields that are not editable. Concrete is basically, does this field have a data? Does this field have a connection on the database? Does this field have a respective column on the database? Then we have other information, like, for example, does the field have a relation with another model? So is relation. And then if it has a relation, what type of cardinality does it have? So we have, you know, one-to-many, many-to-one, many-to-many, one-to-one. We have four different types of cardinality, and who knows, you know, this is just, this is just a draft, but, you know, it could be an interesting idea. Then we have other flags, and, you know, I just call them data flags. This is my sort of terminology. And that's basically, what's the name of the field? What's the queryable name? And so, for example, if it's a forward field, as I was saying before, a forward field is just going to be basically the name of the field that you define. If it's a related object, and so it's a reverse field, then the queryable name is going to be the related query name. So the name that we're going to be able to use as part of the reverse relation. Then we have this, which is actually a Boolean flag, but I don't know why it's added in data. My fault. And that's basically, this is quite an interesting one hidden, because we have some fields sometimes that are used as part of other fields. So an example is generic foreign key. Generic foreign key uses two fields to work, and that is an auto field, which says the index, the ID of the model it's pointing to, and the second one is a foreign key to the type of model it's pointing to. And so obviously we're never gonna want to modify those fields by themselves, but we only would want generic foreign key to modify it. Okay, that these fields should be modified as consequence of generic foreign key being modified. And therefore, we should never expose them as part probably of a form or something similar to that. Finally, we have one which is called model, which is basically the model that contains the field. And then we have, if the field has a relation, well, then it's basically, there's also a referred model. So which model is this field pointing to? What's the class of this model? And so basically the vision is that we are able to do something like this. And what it looks like is basically querying get fields or these cache properties and be able to do filtering this way to actually narrow down and get exactly what type of fields you want. And this is obviously if you're using get fields. Most probably, as I said previously, you're just going to be using the cache properties because probably they're just what you want. So this is just an example of what you probably would like to see. So for example, I don't know, search for all the fields that are concrete. So this property actually already exists. It's not implemented on every model, but on every field. But yeah, this is basically the vision. So you'll be able to do filtering this way. And so this basically concludes our yesterday, today, and tomorrow in terms of where we were previously, where I am currently, and sort of my vision for the future. But as I also wanted to speak about, as I said, you know, we've been iterating over many, many times throughout the design. And so I think it's really fundamental to show you how much me, Russell, and everyone else in the community has worked to make this API what it is today. And you know, as I say, we changed so much the design, but the design we have today would never have been able to exist if it wasn't for all those past iterations, right? So the first thing we did, So the first thing we did as part of the old API is basically trying to spot the pattern. Unfortunately, the Meta API doesn't have a documentation, and it's got a lot of redundant code. So the first thing that was supposed to be done is basically spot the pattern inside the old API. And that's how we identify those four, let's say, cache properties that are used inside the system. You know, fields, many-to-many, related objects, related many-to-many. As you can see, there are, interestingly, some only cache functions. And so we said, there's a lot of redundancy in this. And so what we're going to do is we're going to create one single API, which is called getFields, compacting all those four, let's say, field types inside a main API. This is great because we have far less redundancy. Things are far, far more simple, but it's nothing more than a refactored API. We want to do more. We want to make sure that this API is something new that you guys will want to use. And so what we want to do is make this API even more simple. Finally, other important things is that generalizing can be really hard. And some of the entry points for example, related objects had other arguments. And it's really hard to create a matrix out of, let's say, all the field types and all the field options. So, you know, this is not the right we'll want to use. And so what we want to do is make this API even more simple. Finally, other important things is that generalizing can be really hard. And some of the entry points for example, related objects have other arguments. And it's really hard to create a matrix out of, let's say, all the field types and all the field options. So, you know, this is not the right way. So it was banned. And so we went to something actually quite interesting, which is using bit fields as part of
Basically, we wanted that flexibility in terms of we wanted to be able to have a sort of a sparse API in terms of we could concatenate things together while searching for specific things. And yeah, it was flexible, but there's some big problems with that, and that is, you know, first of all, it requires imports, and it shouldn't require imports to use an API. It's ridiculously anti-Pythonic, but it also caused a lot of problems with circular imports, and that was a big problem. So yeah, that was banned. Then we went all the way up to 9 plus field options. And these flags, you know, using flags is far better. Okay, we could express basically the same thing in flags. Plus, we made another additional distinction, which is basically between pure, and pure means without relations. Forward means with relations pointing to a model, like for example a foreign key. And then we had reverse, which is in this case related, which is basically pointed, something that points to me as a model. And yeah, this matrix, you know, describes what we have now. But as I say, I don't think, you know, it wasn't future. We realized that it wasn't future proof. And plus, you know, it's too many properties. So we just really were saying we have to go through something far more simpler to use. So that was banned too. And this is basically what we started doing. We started saying instead of trying to fit everything, make the separation between these two main, let's say, distinction points that are forward and reverse, which are fields and related objects currently. Just make it that simple, and then do the rest of the filtering outside the API using flags or using something else. But the API should be as less complex as possible. And, you know, part of the operations should be done outside to make sure this is simpler. And this is also great because it's far easier to maintain. Finally, I'm not sure we are there yet in terms of there are some future projects in Django that could not be entirely compatible with this. And so this is what we're going to be finding out the next day. So, an open source project is nothing without its community. Please give me feedback. I live on feedback. Yeah, if you're coming to sprints, approach me, hug me, come and have a chat with me. Yeah, I hope, you know, I'm sure we'll have something to share. And if you have some ideas, even though they're stupid, don't worry, my ideas are going to be 1,000 times more stupid. So, you know. Finally, a huge thanks to these people that have made the project so great. Russell! Where is Russell? There he is. A big clap for Russell! Yes. And also Colin Anderson, which unfortunately, he's not here today, but he's been really, he's helping me so much. Tim, where is Tim? No. Yeah. Lloyd. And see many more. And plus, thank you so much for the Dutch Django Association, Ola, Mark, and everyone else, because this is an amazing conference. Thank you so much.
Any questions? Russell's got a question.
Okay, so the one part of this that you didn't talk about is sort of, well, not so much really the why, but the proof of concept that you did along with it. Not something that's going to be part of anything that's in Django, but a proof of concept side project that validated that what you were doing was actually worthwhile. I wanted to talk a little bit about that and slightly bigger picture why anyone else might care for the same sort of thing.
You're right. So there was a point where instead of looking at my emails on Gmail, I was using the Django administration panel to do so. And I actually managed to send emails for that too. I actually have a picture on the Django Google Groups. But basically, the bigger picture is this. And I didn't want to speak about it too much because it's still something that I really felt we had to validate before in terms of, yeah, this is the biggest vision, but are we there yet? And that's the big question. That's why I wouldn't speak about it that much. But it's basically, we will be able to build, when this APIs, I'm saying this is great for what we have now, but it's not future-proof. And when I speak about that is that we want to enable developers to build their custom stores. So we want developers to build their own Mongo store. We want developers to build their email store, in the case of my Gmail store. And the idea is that you'll be able to plug in your store, just implement two functions, like, for example, get fields and get field or something like this. All the rest are pre-computed cache properties. They're done for you. And so you'll be able to go with an official API. So that is, I hope I answered the question there. So that is the bigger vision.
How do you deal with places where Django needs one API internally, but if, as developers, we need introspection, we need a different API? A simple example would be one-to-one fields, where usually you get a related object on one side and a field on the other side, even though it's the same type of relationship when you're trying to use it.
Okay, so interesting. There's this big thing because, as I said previously, this API, even though it's unofficial, it's used by a lot of people, right? It's already used by a lot of people, a lot of projects, unofficially. And so part of it now is that currently we are 100% backwards compatible. We are 100%, everything that has been working for you previously works on my current pull request. Plus, you know, we just give you a warning saying if the API is not used anymore, you're going to have a warning saying, you know, please change it. And we also give you an upgrade path. So trying to be as verbose as possible. In terms of that, there are some parts of the system that we're going to, we might be able to change, but I don't want to speak about that yet because we're going to be speaking about that tomorrow. So if you want to join, you know, it's great.
More questions?
Now that the API is official and supported, is the underscore going to go away?
Well, that's a question I've already had. And so the idea is that this is going to be an official API, but we still... Okay, so first of all, the underscore is always going to be there because it has to be backwards compatible. Okay?
And because someone might have a field called meta.
Yeah, exactly. But then we're not really sure. We had this, well, at least I had this idea of adding a sort of a get meta call or something, sort of a more usable accessor name. But for now, we're not currently sure, and I personally don't think so. I think that it's an API that is a very internal API. We're making it public because we want everyone to use it, but most people, I'm sure, that will be able to use Django without it, and you know, won't necessarily have to use it.
Yeah, I guess whilst it's still really a part of the internals, even if it's a public API. So
yeah, which makes it quite strange because you know it's underscored. So you know, we're making it official, but on the other side, you know, we're not really sure if. It's a good idea to sort of create a sort of a public property on top of that.
Any more questions? Tom?
So what's the status of the old bits of the UnderMeta API? Are they going into pending deprecation, or are they just being killed, or...?
So the API is 100% backwards compatible. That means that every call is supported and gives the same return types, okay, currently. And the way we did that is quite interesting because we first, as part of my first, let's say, pull request, I created a test suite on top of the existing meta, which is currently merged into master. That's already there. Then what we did is then we built the new API on top of the old one, and we made sure that the return types were exactly the same. The only thing we're doing more is that, yes, if the entry point has been deprecated, like, for example, 80% of those entry points have been deprecated, you will have a warning. You will have a warning saying this API is going to be, you know, as part of Django's sort of official deprecation process, even though that has never been official.
Any
questions?
Sure.
Hi. Some fields in the normal model are related to each other, not in the way of the generic foreign key which you addressed, but say image field can update the height and width fields on a model, and is that actually reported or somehow handled in the API? And also, image field and file field are also special in other senses, and also you haven't addressed that.
Yes. As you said, basically these fields handle other fields as part of their, they work through other fields. And personally, I don't know how these fields are implemented now because I haven't actually looked at those specific internals. But what I can tell you is that once, if this flags API is approved, okay, and if we manage to build this flags API on top, then what that means is that the fields that are used to back the image field, the fields that are used to back the file field, those are gonna have the hidden flag. And what the hidden flag is gonna tell the system is, this field exists, but it exists as a consequence of this other bigger field working. Does that answer your question, or...?
Not really.
Okay.
Because the height and width field... Sorry, the height and width fields related to an image field are not hidden and not to be used like the content type, say, of the generic foreign key. They are independent fields. They're supposed to be read-only, but... the thing is, if you're writing some sort of application that manages metadata, that like the admin or those kinds of applications, you want to know about the relation between these fields and the other field.
Okay, so I think I understood the question a bit better now. Sorry about that. I think I don't think we will be exposing away from a big field to understand the relation with other fields. All I can say is that I'm sure that on a field construction, those fields are, it's going to probably accept some fields as parameter, and then those fields are going to be sort of hooked inside somehow. But that's an interesting thing, and we should speak about that tomorrow, actually.
Any more questions? In that case, thank you very much, Daniel.
Thank you.